Good afternoon, my name is Jared, and I'll be your first affirmative speaker in today's debate. Having eradicated smallpox, polio, and essentially eliminating diseases that were once virtually unavoidable, childhood vaccination in the U.S. has saved more lives than all of the miracle drugs of the latter half of the 20th century combined. But reminiscent of Garrett Hardin's The Tragedy of the Commons, falling vaccination rates due to erroneously perceived risk jeopardize public health. The affirmative defines state-mandated as a mandatory school vaccination, exemption, and emergency vaccination provisions in the status quo. Resolve, state-mandated administration of childhood vaccinations is justified. My partner and I affirm today's resolution for the following three contentions. Contention 1, mandates effectively increase vaccination rates. Contention 2, mandates guarantee a stable vaccination market. And contention 3, mandates encourage equality in healthcare. Our first contention is that mandates effectively increase vaccination rates. The Community Preventative Service Task Force found that mandates caused a 34.3% increase in vaccination rates. The first of the CDC's 10 great public health achievements of the 21st century, vaccinations have an unprecedented capacity to prevent disease, and even if a vaccinated child contracts a disease, the symptoms are less severe. Widespread vaccination rates also protect those who are not vaccinated through herd immunity, a process that protects unimmunized individuals by immunizing those around them, thus preventing the spread of disease. All in all, high vaccination rates obtained through state mandates benefit the health and safety of Americans, as well as their wallets. Dr. Fang Junzhou found that 7 mandated childhood vaccinations prevented about 13.6 million cases of disease and 13,000 deaths, and saved about $10 billion and $43.3 billion in direct and societal costs per annual birth cohort. Through mandates, early childhood vaccinations have become an American cultural norm. State mandated childhood vaccinations are the only way to guarantee continued and future widespread vaccination in the United States, thus ensuring America's health now and for always. Our second contention is that mandates guarantee a stable vaccination market. As stated in our first contention, mandates guarantee high vaccination rates, thus creating a predictable stability within the vaccine market. The stability in the market is extremely important, as 46% of the US vaccine industry's research and development budget comes from the vaccine sales. Because FDA approval can take 7 or more years, a stable funding base is extremely important to the development of new vaccines. A recent America Speaks poll found that 60% of Americans don't believe we are making enough progress in medical research, and with the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases observing that 16 new pathogens emerged in the last 20 years, we need new vaccines now more than ever. Our final contention is that mandates encourage equality in healthcare. While all men are created equal, inequalities in healthcare inhibit the ability of some to exercise their right to life. Mandates reduce these inequalities. Currently, mandated vaccines are made affordable either through health insurance or the Vaccines for Children program, which provides vaccines to the uninsured. However, in addition to socioeconomic inequalities, mandates also reduce racial inequalities as well. An Illinois-based study analyzing the effects of childhood vaccine mandates found that vaccine mandates reduce racial disparities in vaccination coverage. In post-mandate cohorts, the disparity between Caucasians, African Americans, and Hispanics decreased as much as 7%, and by the 9th grade, 89% of African Americans were vaccinated, as opposed to 32% in the pre-mandate cohorts. Dr. Julie Weimarita concluded that, quote, school vaccination requirements can be an effective public health tool to prevent disease regardless of race or ethnicity, end quote. Mandates help our country to realize the ideals that it was founded on, that all people, regardless of class or creed, should have an equal right to life. For the aforementioned contentions, that mandates effectively increase vaccination rates, guarantee a stable vaccination market, and encourage equality in healthcare, we ask for your vote in the strongest affirmation in today's debate. Thank you.
How did you say? Hi, thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Cole. I will be the first negative speaker for the following resolution. Resolved, state-mandated administration of childhood vaccinations is justified. My partner and I disagree with today's resolution for 3 reasons. First, vaccinations pose many potential health risks. Second, a state mandate results in the unnecessary application of vaccines, thereby creating stronger and more resilient diseases. Third, parents make informed decisions that have the constitutional right to their child's health and well-being. First, childhood vaccinations pose risks to children that cannot be overlooked. Epidemiologists Drs. Merwitz and Morgenstern of the UCLA School of Public Health demonstrated in a comprehensive study that vaccines, quote, initiate permanent changes in the structure and function of immune, neural, and endocrine components, resulting in aberrant immune responses. They go on to explain that the application of vaccines at certain vulnerable stages in life, such as childhood, directly results in chronic pain, major depression, and psychological distress. In light of the many dangers directly tied to childhood vaccinations, the United States Department of Health and Human Services releases a report each year documenting all claims of personal injury made against vaccine manufacturers. Requests compensated through the order of the United States Court of Federal Claims include chronic arthritis due to the rubella vaccine, brain swelling caused by the measles vaccine, and even death from receiving the pertussis vaccine. Second, the unnecessary application of state-mandated vaccinations creates even stronger, more resilient diseases. Here's a quick analogy. MRSA, or multiple resistant Staphylococcus aureus, has developed an immunity against antibacterial treatments from the overprescription of antibiotics. Previous treatments for MRSA are now no longer effective as the bacterium has attained a form of antibiotic resistance. In a similar way, vaccinations are beginning to prove ineffective against certain diseases. A collaborative study conducted by 9 researchers, doctors, and healthcare professionals investigated the emergence of the serotype 19A, a virulent and multi-drug resistant disease which developed as a result of the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine. Their work, published in the Pediatric Infectious Disease Journal, reports that a, quote, significant increase in invasive disease due to serotype 19A was observed. Unnecessary, across-the-board vaccinations have thus resulted in the development of resilient diseases and have diminished our ability to combat them. As you can see, the unnecessary administration of vaccines proves not only ineffective, but also dangerous. Finally, parents should hold the right to decide whether childhood vaccinations are worth the health risks. Judges, there's enough evidence provided proving that vaccines do indeed carry inherent risks. We argue that given these risks, parents must be allowed to make the decisions about their child's health care. The Parental Rights Amendment in the Constitution gives parents the right to total control over the upbringing of their child. Even in the instance of terminating life support, the Supreme Court ruled that parents make all of the medical decisions with due process of law. It is the right and duty of parents to weigh the physical and psychological risks inherent in a vaccine against its potential benefits. Furthermore, parents do not make these decisions with a lack of information. In actuality, these parents make thoughtful and rational choices when deciding not to vaccinate their children. In a study conducted by Drs. Sporton and Francis, all parents who do not immunize their children cite the realized risks associated with vaccines as the principal reason for opting out. These parents who are making rational and research-supported choices should be allowed to make decisions regarding the welfare of their child. A state-mandated administration of vaccines not only endangers the health of American children, but also infringes upon the constitutional rights of parents who alone may decide what is best for their child. My partner and I disagree with today's resolution for 3 reasons. First, vaccinations pose many potential health risks. Second, a state mandate results in the unnecessary application of vaccines, which creates stronger diseases. And third, parents make informed decisions and hold the constitutional right to their child's health and well-being. Thank you, and ask for your strongest negative vote for today's debate.
Hey, what's your evidence regarding your first contention about the 34.3 increase in vaccine coverage?
And can we see the evidence about the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine and the evidence about the risks of vaccines from that university quiz? Here's the evidence.
Judges ready?
Here.
I believe I have the first question.
Yes.
So in regards to your third point, yes, that parents should have the choice to vaccinate their children, I'd like to ask, should a parent have the right to put their child or other children at risk through their choices?
I believe that the risks presented by the vaccinations are minimal, maybe minimal or diffuse, but however, they present serious risks to some children, and therefore we must give parents
but
the right.
But you acknowledge that these risks are minimal.
In some cases, in certain vaccines, yes, but in other vaccines, they've been proven to cause death and other serious.
But how often do these vaccines cause death or severe allergic reactions?
I believe my partner can bring that in evidence from the next.
Sure. Do you have a question?
Yes. Now, you stated that in your third contention, something about the vaccine for children program. Now, would this program not exist without mandates?
No. And my partner will actually go over that later on in his
Okay.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
So, under your second point on vaccines creating a resistance, Now, you mentioned MRSA. Now, I'd like to ask, did MRSA mutate from vaccines or antibiotics?
I'm sorry, MRSA was an allergy that adapted from over-prescription of antibiotics. However, we're seeing a similar effect in the overdosage of vaccinations.
But you do acknowledge that, so it's the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine. You do acknowledge that that's only one vaccination out of the many that are currently mandated. So, since it's only one vaccination, would you agree that the rest of these vaccinations that haven't caused resistance are indeed beneficial?
I believe that there's some benefits to them, but I also affirm that there are definitely risks similar to that, because the cycles that are shown in the evidence can be repeated for any vaccine. Let me ask a question.
Yes.
You described in your third contention a racial disparity.
Yes.
Well, what is the cause of this?
I believe the cause of this was the mandates that were put in place.
The mandates created a
disparity? Yes. Or, no, the mandates reduced the disparity. As I said in my case, in post-mandate cohorts, which is after the mandate, the disparity between Caucasians, African Americans, and Hispanics decreased as much as 7%. And by the ninth grade, 89% of African Americans were vaccinated, as opposed to 32% in the pre-mandate cohorts.
This constitutes a post-hoc ergo propter hoc fallacy, don't you agree? Because you're saying that because something happened after, it necessarily happened because of it.
Well, actually,
how can you be sure?
My partner will go over that. But actually, on that fallacy, I'd like to question your second point on resistance, because does the evidence that you gave us on the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine prove the causation from the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine to these resistances that are being created?
Yes, the study demonstrates that there is indeed a correlation and causation factor, and we'll bring that up in our following speeches or later in the debate.
Okay. Do you have a question?
How much time do we have?
5 seconds.
Okay.
Judges ready? Timekeeper. Opponents. Hello, my name is Ben, and I will be your second affirmative speaker in today's debate. During this time, I'd like to go over my opponents' points, and if time permits, go over some of the attacks that they have made on ours or will make on ours. Now, in regards to my opponent's first point, that there are a variety of health risks associated with vaccinations, I'd first like to point out that evidence from the CDC states that these risks that they cited, like, just for example, the brain swelling and whatnot, happen, quote unquote, so rarely that experts are unable to determine whether or not that the vaccines cause, whether they're caused by vaccination or not. So first of all, there are an entire slew of risks like the brain swelling, et cetera, in the first half of their point falls because experts cannot conclude this. Second of all, in regards to allergic reactions, while we do acknowledge that 1 out of every million from the CDC receive an allergic reaction after vaccination, we will say that 1 out of every million is statistically negligible. Furthermore, these allergic reactions are happening immediately after the child receives the vaccination shot. In other words, they're happening in a doctor's office mere feet away from an EpiPen, the drug which stops allergic reactions. So yes, while the child's airways might constrict for a few seconds, the doctor will grab the needle, inject the child, and the child's life will essentially be saved. So the health risks associated with vaccination are negligible, and that the risks are outweighed by the benefits of the mandate. Now, in regards to their second point, that there is the superbug, I'd first like to refute their analogy that MRSA was mutated in regards to antibiotics, not vaccination. So this analogy falls. And in regards to the serotype 19A, I will question their direct evidence. The long-term effects of selective pressure from conjugate pneumococcal vaccine on serotype distribution and antimicrobial resistance of carrageen-invasive isolates of Streptococcus pneumoniae are unknown. This is their evidence, which states that it is unknown. This evidence then goes on to say, which my opponents interpret to be causation, that the majority of new sicknesses are caused by this new disease. NVT, the new disease, caused 72-91% of invasive pneumococcal disease annually in children less than 5 years of age. So yes, this study says two things. One, we don't know the effects of vaccination on this new disease. And two, that it's this new disease getting sick. But what this piece of evidence does not say is that this new disease is caused by vaccinations. The link does not exist, and my opponents are guilty of their own logical fallacy, post-hoc ergo propter hoc. So this point falls as well, and once again, even if these risks do exist, they are outweighed by the benefits of a mandate. Now in regards to their final point, in that parents make informed decisions. Now this point entirely relies on the fact of the concept that parents have total control over their child. This is completely untrue. The parent's right to choice is overrided the second it begins to infringe upon the child's right to life or the right to life of other children. Once a parent's decision starts to negatively impact the health of a child, it must be stopped because it is infringing upon the inalienable right to life of a child. A New York court ordered that some parents
give their kids a vaccination in regards to a measles outbreak because of this very principle. Parents did not want to get their kids vaccinated, but these children were going to get measles from this measles outbreak that was going on within their congregation, so they had to get vaccinated. And this is what the judge ruled, setting a judicial precedent for the overruling of a parent's right to choice by the right to life of the child. Now, going on to some of the attacks that I am anticipating that they will make on our case. In regards to our first point, and that mandates increase vaccination rates, my opponents will have to prove, using evidence from the United States, that a voluntary system can achieve the same level of vaccine coverage as a mandate, or they cannot claim any of the benefits the affirmative presents. Furthermore, even what our evidence says, that there is a 34.3% increase from a mandate, shows two things. One, that mandates increase rates, and what do mandates increase rates from? What is the system that exists before a mandate? A voluntary system. So this piece of evidence proves two things. One, mandates increase vaccination rates, and two, that a voluntary system has vaccination rates 34.3% lower than a mandated system. Now, in regards to the inequality point, my opponents kind of touched on this in regards to the Vaccine for Children program. The Vaccine for Children program falls under the administration part of this resolution. The administration, the Vaccine for Children program, is the means by which these vaccines are administered. Furthermore, the study we brought up actually said that it was the mandate that reduced the inequality in healthcare coverage, not the Vaccine for Children program. So even if my opponents assert that taking away the mandate will leave the VCF program, they do not actually contradict the evidence, which explicitly states that it was the mandate itself which caused reduction in inequality. And it is for those reasons that I ask for your strongest affirmation in today's debate. Thank you.
Can you see your evidence showing that it was indeed the mandate that reduced inequality?
Yes, of course.
Okay. May I take a minute of time, please?
Yeah. Judges ready? Timekeeper? Opponents?
Yes.
Pardon?
Yes.
Hello, my name is Keenan, and I'll be the second negative speaker for today's debate. First, I'd like to go over my opponent's case. If time permits, I'd like to refute the attacks that they made on our own case. So my opponent's first contention discusses how state mandates increase vaccination rates. They state that their study shows that during a period of mandated vaccinations in a certain number of countries, vaccination rates increased by 34.3%. However, in their evidence, there is no way to determine whether causal relationships between there are causal relationships between these two events. In other words, a mandated system likely did not directly cause the increase in vaccination rates. So let us take Italy as an example, as they state in their piece of evidence. In 1981 to 1983, there were no immunizations taking place in Italy. Therefore, their vaccination percentage was zero. When a vaccination system was implemented, rates increased from 0 to 90%. This change in prevalence rate skews the data because Italy had no vaccinations in the first place. Therefore, a mandated system did not cause this large increase in vaccinations necessarily, but their introduction to the public may be an alternate key determinant in the percentage increase, not the mandate itself. Because the benefits of vaccines are so high, like my opponent state, a mandated system is not necessary in order for people to realize the benefits of vaccinations. With a non-mandated system, we can maintain the public health, like my opponents say, and we can protect the parental rights and avoid over-vaccination. Now, my opponent's second contention, they state that a state mandate creates a stable market for vaccines. They assume that because vaccine companies will always have customers under a state mandate, the vaccine companies will be urged to create better vaccines because they will always have customers. This argument is flawed for two reasons. First, according to the Health Policy Forum, quote, only a handful of suppliers are currently positioned to play a role in the vaccine market. High startup costs and specialized expertise requirements restrict market participation to the limited amount of entities capable of mobilizing both the significant capital and highly skilled labor necessary for vaccine development and commercial production, end quote. These barriers to the market indicate that the vaccine market is either a monopoly or an oligopoly. In these two types of markets, barriers to entry create less competition. Competition is what spurs innovation, but we have no competition in our current market. So what is spurring this innovation and this efficiency in vaccinations? Actually, it is the fact that in the vaccine market, there is an innate drive in those vaccine firms to create a superior product. This incentive will remain with a non-mandated system because the vaccine firms want to create a good product. They are not creating a good product because of this state mandate. And here's the second reason why the contention is flawed. Under a mandated system, they don't have an incentive because actually, in reality, they always have customers under a mandated system. So in essence, this is actually a disincentive to actually create better vaccines. Under a non-mandated system, it is essential for these companies to create better vaccines because they now have competition. because they don't always have customers. Competition now remains in the market, and now these firms now have a way to say we need to create better vaccines, and this is the incentive that my opponents are talking about. So if anything, under a non-mandated system, we will create a stable market. Now, under their third contention, they state that with a state-mandated system, there will be equality in healthcare, and they assume a causal relationship between race and the inability to obtain vaccinations under a non-mandated system because of these higher prices. However, it is not the racial factor that would keep people from obtaining the vaccinations. Instead, it is the lower socioeconomic bracket. But here's where the contention is flawed. Because first, the government and healthcare systems would still subsidize childhood vaccinations with or without a mandate. Healthcare would still cover for it because of the benefits of vaccinations. And even if you didn't believe that the government would continue to implement these or to continue to subsidize, the government only currently presents, according to the Task Force for Child Survival and Development and the National Immunization Program and the Center of Disease Control, only 5% of childhood vaccinations were purchased through state and or the local government. So even if the government did not take a good part in these subsidies, their presence is negligible in the big factors in the scheme of things under a mandated system. That's why I'd like to ask for your strongest negative vote in today's debate. Thank you.
Timekeeper, what was the time on that last speech? Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. You asked the first question.
Okay. Now, in attacking my second point, you talked a lot about these barriers for entry. You did not prove that the mandate was actually a barrier for entry. You cited high startup costs and regulations, but you did not cite the actual mandate. The mandate is not a barrier for entry, wouldn't you agree?
Well, under this current mandated system, right, you force people to go and get vaccinated, correct?
Yes.
So in essence, we have only a few firms creating vaccinations, correct?
Well, no.
How many firms create vaccinations?
Well, once again, you cited the evidence citing the number of firms, but what I'm asking you is, how can you prove that the mandate is this barrier of entry? Your evidence cited high startup costs and regulations, but not mandates.
No, what we're saying is that the reason why there are barriers to entry is because there are so few firms because of these high startup costs to start these vaccination companies. Because
yes.
There are these barriers to entry, competition under a state-mandated system is very limited.
But what you don't actually address is a mandate a barrier for entry? You don't address this. You keep talking about these barriers for entry, but you don't actually say that they're mandates.
But the real crux of the argument is that under a state mandate, we force people to become these people's customers, correct?
Yes.
So under a non-mandated system, if they don't have guaranteed customers, wouldn't that spur them to create better vaccines?
Wouldn't you agree that companies oftentimes cut corners and cut safety regulations in order to make more profits?
Well, that would be illogical to do because one,
Enron.
Enron
happened. Enron was a for-profit company. Under my opponent's analysis, they would never do something illegal because that would reduce their customers. And yet, they created this multi-million dollar hoax.
First of all, actually, and I'd like to see your evidence for this, and also, it is illogical for any vaccination company to create a subpar vaccination because a lawsuit that is filed against them would be insurmountable compared to the amount the people will file for this lawsuit will not make up for any of the sales. Well, will make up for all the sales. So in other words, any sales they make off of this bad vaccination would be trumped by any lawsuit that is filed.
Yes, and this is exactly why we need to protect these companies, because before the Vaccine National Compensation Fund was enacted, you had companies going out of business. The reason why for the mandate and the Vaccine National Compensation Fund is that so we can ensure these companies stay in business. Juries who weren't actually medical doctors were believing the crying mother saying that the vaccines gave their kid autism and giving her a multi-million dollar settlement and driving these companies out of business. This mandate is why we still have vaccine companies in America and why our kids are healthy.
I believe you're actually making an assumption on your own, because the real crux of the argument is that the reason why competitors are driven out are because these vaccination companies are already stabilized and they already have all the tools they need in order to...
So under your analysis, in a free market economy, you have tons and tons of companies, that all these new startups and whatnot, right?
But we don't have a free market with the vaccination.
Right,
monopoly,
yes, but that's what you're saying. Under a voluntary system, you have all these different companies competing with one another, right?
No, it's the companies that we have now would be spurred with more competition.
Yes, the
now,
new pop-up companies would be competing with them, correct?
No, there will not be new pop-up companies, but there will be competition within the companies that does not exist today.
So, how do you account for the fact that without this guaranteed sales, they would not be able to develop new vaccines because they don't have the stability in the market
so
to ensure the lengthy FDA approval process?
So, in essence, you're saying that people will stop vaccinating themselves because there is no mandate?
I'm asserting that mandates increase vaccination rates, as we've proven.
Well, actually, you haven't proven that. Like I stated in my first argument against your first case, your study doesn't say anything about the fact that mandates cause the increase in vaccination rates. Like I said, in Italy, it goes from 0 to 90% because they didn't have vaccination rates in the first place. So your evidence is actually skewed because the numbers that you are using is actually quite like they're outliers and they skew your evidence.
They're outliers? A median absolute increase, a median which is more or less the average, not exactly what it is, it's comparable. The median is an increase, so how can you say it's an outlier?
Wait, actually, do you even know what a median is? Like what is your, the thing is a systematic study, correct?
Yes.
So a systematic study actually takes, like it says in your thing, we have children, high school, and college students.
Well, I see
right?
We're out of time, so I'll answer your question about the median.
Okay.
You have seven numbers, three on one side and three on another. You take the middle number, and that's the median.
Judges ready?
Thank you.
Judges, I would like to set up a framework for judging today's debate, and that framework is voting on human life. And we, the affirmative, so far in today's debate have proven that yes, vaccines are in the best interest of preserving human life. And now if we look through the flow in today's debate, we've proven multiple times that vaccinations have increased, or mandates have increased vaccination rates by 34.3%. My opponents refute this simply by saying a study from Italy. However, in our evidence, first off, it does not fall under our framework that which we have set up, which our opponents have not refuted, which is that we're talking about the status quo in the United States. Therefore, we can't take their evidence from Italy. Furthermore, our evidence states that it is 18 studies conducted in the United States found that mandates increase vaccination rates by 34.3%. And even if you don't believe that, Dr. Catherine M. Edwards found that vaccination mandates increase vaccination rates by 15%. And so it's clear that yes, mandates do indeed increase vaccination rates. And then we've said multiple times that mandates guarantee a stable vaccination market. And finally, that mandates encourage equality in healthcare. My partner has said that mandates were what caused the socioeconomic inequalities to lower. And now my opponents are advocating for a voluntary system. However, I'd like to bring up evidence that states explicitly that a voluntary programs do not work. Dr. Catherine M. Edwards stated that voluntary vaccinations fail to stop the spread of disease, and vaccination mandates emphasize the importance of vaccination in the eyes of the public. And furthermore, it's been proven that public information campaigns do not work. And if we look at what the negative has brought up so far, it's clear that they are losing. Because if we look to their first point on how vaccinations pose risk, in the study that they gave us, it says the study itself, first off, it's a hypothesis. And furthermore, in the introduction, it says stimulation of the immune system at critical times of development may induce structural and functional changes. And the key word there is may. It's not, the study does not even prove it. It just shows a correlation. Thank you.
Elaborate on a specific piece of evidence regarding the creation of a disease with enhanced resilience. So consider a certain infection, really any infection, whether bacterial or viral, the responsible antigens will vary slightly in genetic coding like any population sample of any species. As demonstrated by a study from the Pediatric Infectious Disease Journal, certain variances or mutations create an increased resilience against vaccines and thus an increase in infection rates even among vaccinated individuals. While they may be immune to certain non-resistant clones, the serotype investigated in this study has shown its ability to infect children regardless of vaccinations. This phenomenon is known as something as selective pressure, a situation in which certain members of a population are able to reproduce more efficiently and thereby increase both their numbers and their relative population percentage. Now, opponents have tried to refute this evidence by saying that the quoting from this evidence that the long-term effects of selective pressure are unknown. However, going on, they left off a significant portion of this evidence. I quote, early changes demonstrate a reduction in vaccine serotypes and an increase in non-vaccine serotypes among both carriage and invasive isolates. Now, what we have to recognize is that selective pressure takes time. For example, going back to MRSA, we did not realize the effects of overprescribing antibiotics for many years. This study that we cited shows that the early changes do provide a causal relationship between vaccination mandates, universal vaccination mandates, and the creation of a supervirus. Now moving on, this is a pattern that we can in fact see become recreated in any vaccine. This is a pattern that has been seen recreated in bacteria, and you can see it happen in viruses as well. Looking back to the infected patients now, this resilient disease multiplies in its host and spreads to others around it, thereby increasing both the number of people it infects and the rate at which this infection spread. In fact, this rate increases literally exponentially. Therefore, I ask for your strongest negative vote today's debate.
Judges ready? Timekeeper. Opponents.
Yes.
I believe we have the first question.
Mm-hmm.
In the evidence you provided in regards to the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, whether or not it is legitimate, as will be that to the judges to decide, does it actually mention any other vaccines other than the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine?
Well, we actually tried to focus on one vaccine, like an example, saying that with the continued use and the over-vaccination, like it says in the title, universal vaccination.
So that's a no.
However, this is a pattern that is recreated in different.
So you're extrapolating evidence based on a single vaccine.
Does the evidence say that it will happen with other vaccines?
It has been shown to happen in. Hold on, let me read you the exact quote.
Well, also we're saying, like you said in the last one of your speeches, you said that it is this new disease that is actually harming people.
Yes, but once again, your quote, your evidence itself says it is unknown of the effects of selective pressures on the new disease. It goes on to say that the new disease is what's getting people sick, but it doesn't say that vaccines cause the new disease.
Actually, now, as I said in my last speech, the long-term effects are unknown. However, the short-term effects are serious and have been shown to be a causal relationship.
And also,
you did not see this in your evidence. Could you please point it out to me?
Of course.
And also, you stated the staphylococcus things are unknown. However, we're talking about pneumococcus. So actually, you're skewing our evidence just so that it can support your own case.
Excuse me? What I'm saying is that the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine is a single vaccine, and you cannot extrapolate data from it to all other vaccines.
I believe in the discussion you'll find an example in Alaska where a similar situation has occurred.
And was a study conducted on this additional example?
Yes, but this study specifically focuses on.
Do you have this evidence?
It's mentioned.
Can you read this evidence in the debate?
Well, also, we'd actually like to ask you a question about your study.
So that's no.
Well, that is the study right there. So also, we're
asking. There's a single study on the pneumococcal conjugate vaccine, but do you have this other evidence that you say exists?
It is cited in that study. Now, may we ask a question?
Sure. Yes.
What countries are reviewed in your study regarding the 34.3 percentage points in increased vaccination?
United States.
Oh, really? That's kind of confusing because since 1981 to now, our vaccination rates have remained from 96 to 95%. So that is not a 34% increase. So if that's the United States,
that is post-mandate. It has remained at this high amount because we have imposed the mandate prior to this. Now,
states from 1997 to 2009. So that during that period, it's been 96 to 95%. So there is no 34%.
They're what we call retrospective cohort studies, where they reanalyze past data. The data came from before the mandate was imposed, and that's how you get these high vaccination rates, which you refer to, around 90% sustained because of the mandates. And if you don't believe that part, we have a card from Dr. Catherine M. Edwards that found that voluntary vaccination programs fail to stop the spread of disease, and that vaccination mandates increase vaccination rates by 15%. And if you look at the voluntary HPV vaccination, you'll find that it's around 50%, whereas all mandated vaccines hover at around 90%. So voluntary vaccination programs do not work and do not achieve the same levels of coverage as mandated systems.
But how can you say that there's such a huge increase in vaccination percentages in the United States if it's remained the same for the past 10 years or so?
Because the mandate was imposed before the past 10 years. Those past 10 years, which you said with very high vaccination rates, have all had the mandate, which have kept them high.
But it's in your study. It says from 1997 to 2009.
Retrospective cohort studies. They reanalyze old data. I believe we're out of time.
May we see that evidence?
May we have the remainder of our prep time? Now, touching back on the framework that my partner established in his summary speech, we are judging this debate in regards to human life, because human life is the most valuable resource, and as we all know, you only live once. And thus, human life should be protected whenever possible, and it is the most important resource in this debate, and all other impacts pale in comparison to it. And this being said, my opponents have chosen to go full suicide in their summary speech on their superbug points, and I'll address this later on and explain why we have won the debate because of this, but I would first like to point out that my opponents have completely dropped their risk point, and they have not talked about it since I rebutted it in my rebuttal speech. They have dropped their informed decisions point in regards to parental rights. So both these two points fall right there because they've dropped it. Now in regards to their superbug point, first of all, I'd like to address the fact that the evidence they gave us does not actually prove causation. And judges, you can request to see this evidence after the round if you so wish, and I encourage you to do so if you please. So, but one, it does not even establish causation. Even if you believe that it establishes causation, it's focusing on a single vaccine, not the 8 commonly mandated vaccines. So when looking on this resolution on balance, we can't actually say that we should say, no, they're not justified because this one is bad and creates a superbug. No, we can't do this. It's one vaccine, not 8. So those are two strikes against that already. And the third strike is that my opponents want to win this debate on this point alone, as they've established in their summary by going full suicide on it and on this point, they will have to prove that this new disease has actually killed more people than vaccine mandates have saved. Because of the increase in vaccination rates due to vaccine mandates of 34.3%, or if you go with the Catherine M. Edwards alternate findings of 15%, we see that there was a reduction of 42,000 deaths per annual birth cohort because of vaccine mandates, or you can also see there are 2 million prevented cases of vaccine preventable diseases. So, okay, fine. You count off the first strike that it only talks about the hemoinfluenza, the pneumococcus vaccine. Count off the second strike that it only that it doesn't actually prove causation. You still have to confront the fact that vaccine mandates still save more lives and get higher rates than a voluntary program because, frankly, voluntary programs do not work. And it is for those reasons that I ask that you vote in the interest of life and vote in the affirmative in today's debate. Thank you.
My opponent's first contention states that with mandated systems, 34% increases in vaccination rates have been seen in the United States. However, their study actually doesn't deal with the United States because we actually have their own evidence in our folder. And so that means they don't even know their study, for one. And two, according to the World Health Organization, our vaccination rates for the past 10 years have been 96%. So how could it have increased 34% in their study from 1997 to 2009? How could that have been a 34% increase if the vaccination rate was 96%? That would mean more people than we have in our population are vaccinated, which doesn't make any sense at all. They don't know their own study, and therefore their first contention falls. Now their second contention talks about the stable market. And like I stated earlier, we only have a few vaccination firms. That means there is no competition within these firms under a mandated system because they are guaranteed customers. Under a non-mandated system, we will have few firms, but they will have to create better vaccines than the other because they will have to attract customers. Therefore, a stable market is actually brought into the realm with a non-mandated system. We can achieve their benefits with our system, and that is why their second contention falls. Now, the third contention talks about healthcare system equality. However, like we stated, healthcare and government will continue to subsidize vaccinations because of the benefits that are involved. Therefore, the amount of money that is saved and actually the amount of money people have to pay will remain low. Therefore, the lower socioeconomic brackets will not suffer under a non-mandated system. Now, we said that we have dropped our arguments. However, we will not drop our arguments. Our first contention states that there are health risks involved. Like we stated, at a child's continued vaccinations, like 9 vaccinations per visit at the beginning, actually results in brain damage and actually has really detrimental effects. Therefore, we can't mandate a system like this. Also, under a mandated system, we over-vaccinate, like we said, the pneumococcus vaccine. We have seen the effects of a beginning of a disease that we are creating that is worse than the disease that we were treating in the first place. The best decisions are made for the future, and we can accomplish all the benefits of a mandated system with a non-mandated system without infringing upon anyone's rights. That's why I'd like to ask for your strongest negative vote in today's debate. Thank you.